Chapter 4. Mixing the Witch's Brew. Brainstorming is a husky, lusty young man with lots of drive. He will survive and produce dozens of new ideas under the most adverse conditions. He will break out of the chains of convention, conservatism, and just plain sluggishness. He can spark new ideas in every sort of culture, in churches and laboratories, executive suites and machinist shops. He is an extremely hardy young animal. But there is one way to kill him. That is to fit him to a straitjacket. All of us who practice brainstorming must constantly remember this. Brainstorming is not a cult. It must not have a ritual. There are ways I practice brainstorming that I have found most successful. But they are not the only ways. Other people have entirely different approaches, and just as much success. As more people try the technique, there will be more ways of practicing it. After all, brainstorming is a method of creative thinking. It is based on the premise that there are constantly better ways of doing things. New ideas, methods, materials, and ever-changing combinations of old ones. It would be both dangerous and ridiculous if I were to wrap brainstorming in a cocoon of strict rules and regulations. This book will not do that. I will tell you what I have discovered about brainstorming, and I will show you how it has worked. But you have to take it from there. In the next 4 chapters, I will show in detail how the classic brainstorm operates. It has a panel of about a dozen members, give or take 2 or 3. This is an unnecessary restriction. Later in the book, I shall reveal brainstorming techniques which I have used successfully with 2 or 3 people, with several hundred, and with one man alone. The one basic ingredient of any brainstorm session is Osborn's 4 rules. 1. Criticism is ruled out. Adverse judgment of ideas must be withheld until later. 2. Freewheeling is welcomed. The wilder the idea, the better. It is easier to tame down than to think up. 3. Quantity is wanted. The greater number of ideas, the more the likelihood of winners. 4. Combination and improvement are sought. In addition to contributing ideas of their own, participants should suggest how ideas of others can be turned into better ideas, or how 2 or more ideas can be pinned into still another idea. Brainstorming's growth, however, came from the 12-man brainstorm panel, and it is still the size most used, since it is ideal for the corporation which must try so hard to break through its natural limitations and get new ideas. We will follow such a conventional brainstorm through each step from invitation to implementation of its ideas. And then we will study the case history of the actual brainstorm sessions. Remember all the time, however, that only the 4 basic rules are necessary. You have a mission and a challenge to use creative thinking to make your own brainstorm session better and more productive than any that have gone before. Just as there is no negative thinking allowed in the brainstorm session, so there won't be in this book. The secret of a good brainstorming session, like a good proposal of marriage, is spontaneity. And the secret of such spontaneity is, of course, good planning. This most certainly does not mean establishing a forbidden atmosphere. In fact, everything should be done to avoid that. It does mean quiet planning that will make the session relaxed, a success. If you are to be the brainstorm leader, do your job well, but be unobtrusive. Don't tell everyone how much you've done, how much you've worked. Brainstorming is a team effort. Don't try to take the credit. You'll get enough if the group comes up with good ideas. But, like a good team captain, stay in the background yourself. First step in setting up a successful brainstorm session is choosing a problem to be overestimated. I like to catalogue them as either steam shovel or spade questions. A steam shovel question is a broad, general one. One I use in my lectures is, how can we sell more gasoline in our service stations? The biggest fault with that kind of question is that the answers are invariably steam shovel answers, just as vague as the question. For example, the usual answers include improve dealer training, have a better TV show, have faster service. Another great fault of the steam shovel question is that those who are attacking the problem aren't really shooting at the same target at all. They're not thinking about the same problem. One man is thinking about the city service station, and another about the station in a resort area. One man is talking about evening sales, and another about truck sales. Their fire is scattered. One way of fighting this problem is practiced by Howard Schidmarhauser, Director of Executive Action Courses at the American Management Association. He puts the question to be attacked on the blackboard, and then has everyone translate it into his own terms so that a workable definition is produced on the spot and the fire of the group concentrated on that definition. Steam shovel questions do have a place in brainstorming. Often they can dig out the problems you should attack. For example, you might brainstorm the steam shovel question, what obstacles stand in the way of increased gasoline sales in our service stations? Then, out of the 100 or so answered, poor salesmen on the pumps, dirty restrooms, poor national advertising. You can apply judgment and pick out the problems, which is a strategic to attack the moment. Then brainstorm those. In the same way a steam shovel question can discover the boundaries of the problem, I once asked a steam shovel question in a Pentagon session. It was, how can you get more creative thinking in the army? The answers included, put out a staff directive, have the Signal Corps make a movie, get Congress behind it, and have a travelling demonstration team. From those steam shovel questions, you can get a clue to the real problem. One clue was to get creative thinking in the Pentagon. That was brainstormed. And of 75 ideas, one was to have a lobby exhibit on creative thinking in the Pentagon. Then we brainstormed, what would you put in a lobby exhibit at the Pentagon to stimulate creative thinking? Then we were down to a spade question, and we got solid results. A spade question is one that really digs into the problem. Brainstorming works best when it is directly orientated to action. It doesn't work at all well in answering such a judicial question as, should we set up a branch office in San Antonio? It does work well when it is focused on, what should our San Antonio office do to increase resubscriptions? Usually, the first definition of a problem is a poor one. You have to work on it to hone it down to a good cutting edge. Recently, I had a session in which the problem was first expressed as, how can the accounting department improve its services to customers? I asked what customers, and it was amended to read, wholesale and retail credit customers. Since that would split the fire of the group, I found out that retail customers were most important. So, the question was reworded as, how can the accounting department improve service to retail credit customers? We got results. The question should be worded in the shortest possible fashion, but at the same time, it should be limited so the work of the brainstormers can be coordinated. For example, take the problem, how can we build traffic in our service stations? That question has one good element. Professor C.C. Crawford of the University of Southern California has shown that a question starting with a how will get far greater results, but it is still pretty vague. We can limit by asking, for whom? Women drivers? New drivers? Trick drivers? When? Evenings? Holidays? Winter? Spring? Where? Highways? In suburban neighbourhoods? Cities? Farming country? By whom? Small stations? Garages? Large stations? In this way, get down to earth. You have a problem that people can really attack. They can see it, understand it, and therefore they can come up with practical solutions which can be put to work. And, strange to say, the wildest flights of fancy come from the most detailed, earthbound questions. The subconscious is like that. Just about the most important factor in brainstorming is, of course, brains. Picking the right people is a crucial bit of planning that should be done with care. Generally, all of those involved should have some familiarity with the problem, although not all of them should be experts. Sometimes, the man directly responsible for its solution sits in. But some companies find this inhibits other panel members, who think they may seem to be criticising Joe for not having their ideas. This is a real hazard. For often the best ideas are the obvious ones the person closest to the problem has not seen. And even if Joe doesn't yelp when someone mentions ideas he doesn't like, there are grunts, table tappings and glares that get the idea across. To combat this, the man most responsible for the problem may be brought in to give a 5-minute no more briefing or indoctrination on the problem. Then he leaves and the brainstorm begins. What is desired is a potent mixture of specialities, attitudes and backgrounds, which will ignite when in contact with one another. Salesmen, shippers, distributors can help on a technical problem. Scientists, engineers, statisticians can help solve a sales problem. Unfortunately, some of my best friends are in the financial and accounting departments, but they rarely turn out to be good brainstormers, except when among their peers and their professional scowls at the mention of an idea that might cost money can have a very red light effect on other brainstormers. When these money men see the savings which can be made through brainstorming, they very often come around and develop into fine brainstormers. Sometimes association with other workers on a brainstorm panel eliminates the Scrooge stereotype of accountant. And thus, the brainstorm can do a double service. In general, an action group will do better than a broad policy committee in brainstorming. But this again tends more to be due to the questions asked than the basic makeup of the individuals. Actually, important policy questions, if they are really important, can be broken down into specifics. When a problem is vaguely defined, it's a pretty good rule that the real problem hasn't been found. Usually, it is true, however, that the board of directors is a judicial group, passing on ideas rather than thinking up ideas. It profits very greatly from brainstorms at a lower level, but does not itself brainstorm or originate ideas very often. Perhaps it should. And this may be a new horizon for brainstorms to cross. Some board of directors meetings now end with a 10 or 15 minute brainstorm session after all the practical decisions have been made. In some concerns, have at least 2 to 4 women in every brainstorm. Not only for the benefit of female brains, a very powerful ingredient indeed, but also for their stimulating effect on male panel members, who are needled on to better ideas by the battle of the sexes. Other companies like to invite outsiders who know nothing of company policy, economics or history, and care less. These may be rather carefully chosen consultants, suppliers, customers, professors in the general field where the problem lies, or they may just be men off the street, friends who would be likely to provide a new outlook at an old problem. BBDO will invite travelling BBDO salesmen to brainstorm on a Sheraton hotel problem, and some agency housewives when they are thinking up Campbell soup ideas. It is often a good idea to have groups of office boys, secretaries, file clerks, workers of all levels brainstorm a company problem. There are a number of good reasons for this. One is that they often have very good ideas. They see your problems differently because of their perspective. Another reason is that this can increase communication between all levels of management. Still, another is that they can take part in management and enjoy a sense of participation. To have absolute freedom during any brainstorm, however, it's best to pick individuals who are on the same approximate management level. So there are no superiors and inferiors. Brass polishing is not a function of brainstorm. No member of a panel should be able to place his job even slightly in danger by an unpopular idea, or advance his stock by a bit of, "say that's a fine idea-ing after a superior has spoken. It is also a good rule not to have the same group meet together all the time. There are several strong reasons for this. Groups who meet regularly usually evolve a pecking order. Joe can jump on Pete's ideas, but Pete can't strike back. Pete, however, can take a swing at Bob, and Bob can't swing at Joe or Pete, and so on. Another reason is that there are hidden alliances, people who know where their bodies are buried, and will use any momentary unawareness on the part of the opposition to advance their cause in the political hurly-burly of the office. Also, a group who has worked together on the same problems is too well aware of what has been tried and even what has been considered. It is generally unable to see that an old idea may be a new solution, especially if conditions have changed. Finally, the group tends to have an automatic reaction to ideas which slam the door in the face of opportunity. There are strong exceptions to this fact. A company may almost by accident develop teams that seem to spark ideas again and again. BBDO has a basic core of idea men who seem to spark panels, and they sit in on many sessions with changing groups of brainstormers. Too often, however, such groups fall into a pattern in the same way that regular conferences often freeze into a sort of stereotyped mating dance, with each person taking a predictable approach to the problem, and with the results being just as predictable. To combat this, when it is necessary to have the same group, some companies make the members of the panel sit in different chairs, and they have found that a varying geographical combination of the people, on one's right and left and across the table, can make a difference in the level of creativity. One important bit of planning for the brainstorm session is the invitation. Usually, it's a good idea to phone first a week ahead and make sure the people you want are clear for the time you have planned. Since each panel is a small, specially chosen group, it can be disastrous if several members are out of town. Besides the phone call, there should be a written invitation, which clearly shows the time, the place, and perhaps, if it is a new thing in the company, a casual line to show that it is important. For instance, "As you know, BW is behind this and anxious to see what we can do." Of course, before you write that, In fact, before you start brainstorming, you should make darn sure BW is behind you. We'll take up that problem in another chapter. In a regular conference, the subject to be discussed is often kept secret. The participants are giving a mysterious summons. One is the ominous and forbidding. It provides plenty of room for rumour, but little for constructive thought. What's old fuddy-duddy up to today? Is Bill going to get fired? Is the market campaign going to be a flop? This sort of conjecture is destructive and purposeless. There are other reasons that the secret type of summons is a waste of time and energy. It gives many people an excuse to put off work, saying, "Got to go get Fuddy Duddy's conference." And above all, the summoned arrive devoid of ideas, but full of fear and foreboding. Once in the session, a problem is suddenly sprung on the assembled group. There is no chance to have your subconscious work over the problem, no opportunity to think up new ideas. Such conferences are generally a complete waste of time. And one of the reasons is a natural resentment of the way in which the conferees are being treated. The invitation to a brainstorming session must have the problem under attack clearly defined if the session is to be worthwhile. Everyone who attends the meeting should have been thinking about the problem and mulling it over. When they come into the brainstorm room, they should be raring to attack it. Another important point too many companies miss, that the invitation to a brainstorm session must be just that. It should be easy to turn down. That seems contradictory, but it isn't. It should not be a summons. People dragooned into a brainstorm session will hardly ever come up with good ideas. If the individuals invited would rather do other work, let them. Brainstorming will sell itself on results. It cannot be forced down people's throats. It is also wise to encourage the spirit expressed in, "I'd like to send my assistant over. He knows more about that problem than I do." The brainstorm session isn't being held to build up anyone's ego. It shouldn't be a sign of status. It's a sleeves-rolled-up work session designed to attack a problem in a hurry. Here's a typical invitation to a brainstorm used by BBDO. Date. Have it reach participants 2 days before meeting. 2. Name of participant. You are invited to a brainstorm on date, at, place, at, put the time. The problem is as follows. How can we increase the sale of home extension telephones? Extension telephones are available for any room in the house and cost either 70 or 80 cents a month, plus an installation charge of about $2.50. Only about 16% of the home telephones now have an extension. And the company is interested in selling the first one to most of the customers, and additional ones to the old extension users. Here are three examples of the kind of ideas we seek. 1. Give an extension to your mother as a Christmas present. You pay for the installation and the first year's cost. 2. Make an arrangement with carpenters or contractors who do game room or workshop construction in basements. Let them give you names of people who are installing those facilities so you can call and try and sell an extension telephone for that room. 3. Prepare a sales piece to send to people when they inform you that they are moving. Sell the idea of having an extension installed at the same time that the new telephone is put in. This will save an installation charge for the extension. John Jones, Chairman, Office Extension 873. When brainstorming is new in the company, or when an individual is going to attend his first session, it may be well to introduce him to what brainstorming is by sending him some information about it with the invitation. Many companies have booklets which define brainstorming, while others use extensive memos which are sent out to educate first-time brainstormers. The secret of such literature is that it should be specific. It must show how clearly, with practical examples, just how our thought processes work, why we can brainstorm, and how a brainstorm session works. To sell the idea of brainstorming to the reluctant employee, the literature must be spiced with practical, hard cash results, which highly respected concerns have received from brainstorming. After reading this, the new brainstormer should come to the meeting full of curiosity and enthusiasm, and in fact be grateful he has an opportunity to participate in this new adventure. The invitation should clearly state the question to be brainstormed. This gives the subconscious a head start. Once the problem is firmly planted in the subconscious, it may chip away at the project as the individual walks through the plant, sees competitors' problems, flies to San Francisco to a sales convention, mows the lawn Saturday afternoon. When the brainstorm session is held, he may be astonished to find what he has thought up. Willard A. Pluthner, BBDO's Vice President in charge of brainstorming and communications, recommends that problems to be stated as think up new and different ways to. He feels that this approach stimulates people to look out for the unusual, the new ideas that will be outstanding because no one else is doing them in that way. In every case, when a proper question, a spade question, has been decided upon, and the members of the group have been told they will have to come up with new ideas, the subconscious seems to come through. It may, for example, rummage around in the brain, call for memory, and come up with some of those good ideas that the participants had had but had never mentioned in old-style negative conferences, for fear of being laughed at. One company even suggests brainstormers come in with 5 ideas on the subject already written down to give the session a head start. Someone starts with an idea, others start hitchhiking, and the session is off to a rousing beginning. Be sure not to let someone read all his ideas at once. That is deadly. Whatever device is used, the invitation to the brainstorm should be on just one side of one sheet of paper, so the busy man who gets it will have time to read it right away. Know the problem, the place, and the time. It's also a good idea to call his secretary to make sure it's marked on his calendar. There is some debate about when brainstorming sessions should be held. The best answer is whenever they work. That isn't silly. That will change from group to group, business to business. Early in the day seems better than late, especially if you've got a pressure business where people get worn out, or if your members are commuters worried about catching the 5:15. On the other hand, some young companies have their best brainstorms in evening sessions. Breakfast brainstorms have been successful, and even Sunday afternoon brainstorms, around the 19th hole. Some general rules seem in order. Alcohol does usually release inhibitions, but the best results are usually a waste of time. I don't know of a successful 2-martini brainstorm. The ideas may seem brilliant to the participants, but they rarely work out. A big meal makes everyone sleepy and sluggish, not at all in the mood for quick mental gymnastics. BBDO used to have breakfast or dinner brainstorm sessions. Now they gather for a light soup break, Campbell's of course, in the middle of the morning or a light lunch, with soup in a room especially designed for the work, which has yellow walls, light wood table and is packed with the solid results of previous brainstorm sessions. The place can be important. A while back, I was invited to lead a brainstorm session at one of New York's most venerable institutions. Seated around the massive mahogany table in the thick carpeted boardroom, in great leather chairs, the members of the panel were constantly under the disapproving stares of the elders, memorialized in oil portraits. No one could have offbeat, oddball ideas in that room. It would be sacrilegious. And nobody did. Atmosphere is important. Brainstorms can be held anywhere. But they should be held where the members of the group feel at ease. The members of the board in that same New York institution might have had a fine brainstorm in the boardroom, in spite of oiled elders, but not the lower level group gathered for that session. To them, the room held the same awe as a throne room to the serfs in a medieval kingdom. By the same token, a New York Esso garage has remarkably successful brainstorms right in the middle of a busy shop. When they run into a problem, the foreman invites some of the boys over for a short coffee break. They gather around the problem in hand. That certainly would be an atmosphere which would make the board members feel uncomfortable. But for the brainstorm, it is just right. The main thing is to find a room where the members of a particular brainstorming session will feel at ease. The room should not have the personality of the boss who can direct the future of the members. Everyone must feel free and easy. If it is necessary to sit in the boss's office or in a boardroom, then the senior members of the group must move away from their accustomed chairs, sit down the table instead of at the head of it. Sometimes it is best to move out of the company entirely, to a room at a restaurant, hotel or club, so there will be absolutely no tangible reminder of inhibiting company policies. No matter where the brainstormers gather, it is always a good idea to have physical examples of the problem at hand, if possible. If packaging is the problem under question, then have the product and some packaging material where it can be seen, touched, bent or torn. There are as many ways as the imagination can devise to increase the creative atmosphere of a brainstorming session. One is to have charts on the wall showing the number of positive, profitable results from other brainstorms. Another is to have a green traffic light, either in actual model form or on a poster, to remind the individuals that this is a green light session, and everything goes. Some companies even have brainstorming rooms with bright yellow paint on the walls, since scientists have ascertained that yellow is conductive to creativeness. A bit of music to introduce a change of pace from the regular business atmosphere can be useful. Modern art can make people see in different terms. I have often thought short movies which might show our world from the high perspective of a helicopter or the low perspective of a child might be very useful. For example, a company wanting to discover ways to sell children's food better in the supermarket might show a picture of a supermarket as seen from the height of a four-year-old. The age that tugs at mother's skirts and pleads, "Let's buy that, mummy. Hey, mum, let's buy this." Whatever you do, find a place which will make the brainstormers feel free to attack the problem, no holds barred.